हेलो
यस
देवोलीना।
आई एम आई एम हियर
हेलो इज इट देवोलीना।
हेलो हेलो
हेलो इज इट देवोलीना। देवोलीना यू आर
हेलो
म्यूटेड।
मैम
अनम्यूट यू। अनम्यूट
यस
योरसेल्फ।
नो नो
बोलना ये
अनम्यूट।
बोलना हेलो यू हैव टू अनम्यूट
देवोलीना प्लीज अनम्यूट योरसेल्फ। टू कनेक्ट अगेन आई थिंक सम प्रॉब्लम।
Yes, in the meantime, I'm preparing myself to
Sure, she will be.
be able to. Okay, in this way, let me close all these windows. And in
So
this.
Devulina is here. Let us
Hello.
start.
Okay.
Okay, so am I audible, ma'am? Yes, you
Yes.
are audible.
Hello.
Yes, you are
Okay,
audible.
so there are internet issues I'm facing. Okay, so
No.
good afternoon, everyone. The fifth day of the international. The first lecture of today, so I'm going to introduce him now. Professor Fedelisi did his graduate studies from University Federico II. He obtained his PhD at Syracuse University under Professor A.P. Balachandran with a thesis on skarmions. He was a postdoctoral researcher at the Rutherford Laboratory in the UK and in the International Center of Theoretical Physics in Trieste, Italy. In the year 1991, he returned to his alma mater, University Federico II, where he is now professor of theoretical physics. He holds position and also at the Instituto Nuclear di
I can't hear very well, but
Apart from this, he has a number of publications in highly reputed journals like this Physical Review Letter, Physical Review BD, Journal of High Energy Physics, etc. So we are happy to have you, sir, here. So it's over to you now, sir.
very clear. Okay. So I see your chats here on the right. So if you have to ask questions, I may not notice them immediately, but if you want to ask questions, please feel free to do that. I already did it before, I apologize because at some point you may hear the bell of my internal phone ringing. I am expecting a parcel that has to be delivered today. And in case this happens, I will run away for a few minutes to let the people in and get this parcel. So, in case this happens, I am very happy that to do this series of these two lectures. I, of course, having studied with, as Debolina said, I studied with an Indian professor, but even more, I lived and worked and really lived with. Several Indian colleagues when I was in Syracuse from all parts of India. Balachandran is from Tamil, but I had friends all over India. I lived with them, and so I am a very good friend of India. This connection, which goes back now, is 40 years, and I have been postdocing with several people. I had a chance of the old friends here, people I was postdocing in Trieste a number of years ago. So I'm really very happy. And as I said, I'm also an aficionado of Assam tea. And I want to really to congratulate you for the Jubilee, the Silver Jubilee of the university. I think it's an achievement. We are an university which has thinks that history is important. We are one of the oldest universities in the world. We will do 800 years as a university in 2024. And we are the first, the Federico II is the first state university in the world. It was chartered the public university by the Emperor Federico, Frederick II, that was the Emperor, Holy Roman Emperor in 1224 we started. Okay, after this, what I will do? I will give a very brief introduction to quantum groups and of algebras, and there are generalization of group theory, and there are really very different approaches to this topic. I will follow a geometrical point of view, and I will see the quantum groups as a non-commutative geometry version of groups. And I will give then the example of the Kappa Poincaré space and a Kappa Poincaré Kappa Minkowski space. Quantum groups started with really with integral systems, so in classical mechanics, but they just as groups, they have a lot of different application and different point of view. I will use a combination on the, of the following books. Majid's book is probably the, everything I say is there, and most of what everything I say is in there is an excellent book, and is sort of the main reference. Another main reference, which is freely available because on the archive, is a thesis of one of my former students, Alessandra Agostini. Of course, since she was my student, her point of view is the one closest to my personal point of view. And it's a shorter, this was several hundred pages, this is about 100 pages. So it's a short compendium, and more or less follow her. So again, you can find things. There are lots of books on this topic, but I will single out four more. These two, Klimek and Schmidgen and Charlie and Presley, with these titles on quantum groups, are mathematically oriented text, and they are fairly rigorous, and they are, again, like Majid book, complete. Another book is the book of Balachandran, my mentor with Joe and Marmo, who incidentally was, Marmo was my undergraduate advisor. And this is a text in group theory. I don't know if other people in this series have mentioned it, but it has a final part, a final two or three chapters on Hopf algebra. And so this is again a good way. It doesn't have much on Hopf algebras, but it has some chapters. There is a book finally by Biedenhard and Law, and this is probably the most practical one. It has an attitude of really deformation of matrix and representations, and is another excellent book. All of these books are present in electronic way. Of course, you will have to buy them, and I will not endorse finding them on pirate sites, which is something that I cannot say should be done. Okay, so terminology. What is a quantum group? Well, there is a misnomer. A quantum group is not a group and it's not quantum. And in fact, the more appropriate terminology is Hopf algebras. However, there is a reason for calling things with this this way. First of all, why groups versus algebras? Okay, this is something which we often do. I do it even when I teach quantum mechanics. A group, when we think of a group, very often we think of an infinitesimal transformation. So we think they associate Lie algebra, which is the infinitesimal part. So the commutation relation which define the rotation group are, and now this is wrong because those are not elements of the group, they are elements of the Lie algebra. So in general, this is it's not a big problem, because what you do, if you have a Lie algebra, then you exponentiate it and you find a group. for of algebra, things are more complicated, but there is a connection. If I have a of algebra, algebra-like, I can have an object which is group-like, and we may call this the quantum group. But again, I will, the appropriate way of talking is of algebra. Of algebras are objects which can be mathematically been defined, and I will define them. Okay, when I say group, I mean a connected, simply connected Lie group, unless I say otherwise. It's important that it's Lie, but it could be topological, but in general, all the examples I give, it will be a Lie group. So I assume, I have been glancing at what my colleagues have done, so I think that Professor Dashgupta talked about Lie algebra and groups. By the way, I seen parts of his lectures. It's a really tough act to follow Professor Dashgupta. He's an excellent teacher, so he set the standards which I will never reach. And then quantum. What do you mean? What is meant by quantum? Quantum would imply that there is some h bar, the constant of Planck, which is a constant with some dimensions, is an action. No, this is not the case. We have deformations, so we have all the quantum groups that I use have a parameter which. Sorry, there is a misprint here. Have a parameter which, in some limit, when some quantity goes to zero or goes to one or goes to infinity, but there is a limit in which, when some quantity goes in some limit, I find again that I call it classical case. So I will have SU2Q. Q is a number. When this number becomes one, this is the SU2 that we know, and so on. So in this sense, they are quantum. They are quantum because they are deformations, the same way as quantum mechanics is a deformation of classical mechanics, and in the limit of h bar going to zero, you recover classical mechanics. Good news is that the way of finding classical mechanics from quantum mechanics, which is when h bar goes to zero, is very complicated. You cannot take Schrödinger equation and then put h bar to zero. The equation just doesn't make any sense. In this case, as I said, the limit is well defined. It's more like the limit in special relativity. There, things are better defined. You send C to infinity and things are better defined. Again, then let me continue a little bit with this introduction. There are several different approaches to quantum group, and they are so different that if you take two different books, in preparing these lectures, I was looking around for books, text, reviews, etc. And there are some that if you start reading two of them, and it takes several pages for you to find a connection between the two. So my point, I will follow one point of view, which is due to my personal history and my personal preference. And I do this for lack of time and also for my competence. I wouldn't be able to do the introduction to quantum groups, which is the one that comes from integrable systems. I have read something, I know something, but I wouldn't be able to give a lecture on this. And likewise, there are some approaches to condensed matter and other things, the structured nuclei, that I don't know them. And what I will do in the first part, I will introduce generically of algebra. This is fairly common to everyone, and I give several examples. In the second part, I will concentrate to some particular case, which is called Kappa Poincaré, which has to do with the quantum space-time. And it has to do, therefore, with the quantum gravity in some, to some extent, to quantum differential geometry. I don't know how, so this first part, second part are not necessarily the division between first lecture, second lecture. I think that the first lecture will be, first part will go into the second part.
Hello.
Yes, I am here.
I have a question.
Yes.
That for a quantum deformed algebra, I mean a Q-deformed algebra, is it satisfy the associativity or a Jacobi identity?
I will discuss this.
Okay.
I will be associative, and in general, I may also, in the examples I give, there will be associativity, but there is some concept more important, which is co-associativity, and I will discuss these things and Jacobi identity.
And my another question is, for case of SU2 Lie algebra, we can realize by using a two-dimensional harmonic oscillator. They are using some finger mapping, so using the two-dimensional harmonic oscillator, we can construct the SU2 Lie algebra generator. Can we construct the similar kind of Q-deform SU2 algebra using such two-dimensional harmonic oscillator or something like that? Is there any analogy?
Thing which is called the Q-deformed oscillators is a deformation of the algebra of A and A dagger.
Okay.
But I will discuss it. In the book of Wiedenhahn, there is a discussion of this and how this connects with SU2Q.
And what is the physical origin of this deformation? Why this deformation is necessary, and how can we realize this deformation?
Okay, how you can realize, I don't know. Physical origin, as I said, if you call it physical, it has to do, originally they were introduced using in the theory of integrable systems. Integrable systems are classical mechanics systems which are integrable, so their motion is totally regular, like in the end they are like harmonic oscillators. So in the phase space their motion happens in on tori and things like that. Then there are deformations of those perturbations, and in this theory, in this integral systems, these things came out. But the point of view which I use is the one instead in which I take a geometry and I deform the geometry. No, the physical origin of this is quantum mechanics.
Okay.
In quantum mechanics, and I will discuss this at some point, but in quantum mechanics, you start from classical mechanics. Classical mechanics is the function of P and Q, position and momentum, and they, of course, commute. And you have a geometry of phase space. It's a symplectic geometry. You put some structures on this, and you do classical mechanics. Now you deform this mechanics. What you say? You say that the P and Q, so the algebra of functions of P and Q, don't commute anymore. And then this is the archetype of a non-commutative geometry. I will comment on this when I will arrive at the quantum space-time in the second part. So for me, the physical motivation has to do with the quantization of space-time.
Okay.
But different point of view will use quantum groups, same as groups, because if you why were groups introduced? Well, for symmetries in crystallography, but then they are important in quantum mechanics, they are important everywhere. Therefore, let me start now with some definition, and I start with a Lie group G. If you want, you can think of SU2 as a simple case, but you can even think of something simpler. SU2 is a three sphere, but simpler cases, R3 is even simpler. So this is a trivial abelian group of translation, say. Okay, now one way in which a physicist may think of things is to characterize the space with the functions, right? We could say the fields which are defined in it. They form an algebra, functions on some space. Now, topology, which is an important characteristic, is as information which is cut by continuous functions. Continuous functions define a topology in two ways. Smooth functions tell me about differentiability. If I want to know metric structures, then I have to put some Laplacian, for example, some derivatives. Now, in order to treat, in general, a space, we define coordinate functions. Now, coordinate functions are local for the three sphere. For R3, no, but in general, for a sphere, for a curved manifold, they are local. And technically, I say that this gives you the tangent space at that point, but not necessarily. Okay, so I will be fairly general. I will consider the algebra of complex functions on the group. So in general, when I consider algebra of functions, they are complex. I could have functions which are defined on the real or other fields, but to be definite, I will always in these lectures consider complex functions. Now I take these functions and I can add and I can multiply them, and I can multiply them by a complex number so that they form an algebra. And I will call this algebra generically F. Now, I started from a group. This is an example. And the group, however, is not an arbitrary manifold. Not every manifold is a group. And if I have a group, I have some more structures on this manifold. The geometry is richer. Now, if I call G, or G1, G2, and so on, a generic point of G, I have a multiplication. Now, from this geometric point of view, means that if I have two points on this manifold, I have a product, which I call mu, which is a map from two copies, so two points, into one point. And this is trivially. Sometimes one put a little dot here, but in general, you just say a group, you have a multiplication, and you put the two elements. Now, I want you to concentrate on the fact of on the geometry. You know? So I have this manifold, I have a point here, I have a point here, and then I have a multiplication which sends me to a different point. What happens to the algebra of functions? On the algebra of functions, I have a co-multiplication. I will use this co a lot. The OPF algebra is something which has some, takes an algebra which has some structures and makes the dual of the structure. Now, a co-multiplication is something from this algebra, I'm making this example F, into two copies. See, the multiplication was going from 2 to 1. This is said goes from a function into the tensor prop of two functions. Now, a little warning. I will sum freely functions. So the Cartesian product and the tensor product basically become the same, because if I take pairs and then I can start summing them, the basis becomes the basis of the tensor product. So I will use fairly liberally the Cartesian product and the tensor product. For me, is the product. This is because otherwise things will become much longer. If I were to write a proper book or a proper paper, then I would take care of making the differences, etc. But for what we are concerned, two copies is good enough. Otherwise, I things become heavier. So this coproduct takes an element of F, which is a function, small f, and associates to it an element in the tensor product. Now, this is a function of two variables. So delta of f is a function of two variables. And what is this function of two variables? It's a function which I obtain if I multiply the two numbers. Okay, so I start with a function f, which is a function of one variable, and I define a function of two variables. So this is delta of f. But this co-multiplication must take into account the fact that it's a group, so that this algebra is the algebra of functions of a group, and this is the connection. So I have a function of two variables which works this way, such that if I there is so that if I have two numbers, see, if I have two elements of the group, in the end I should get a number, complex number. And this is the complex number which I get. Okay? Now there are other structures. For example, the group has an identity, and that has an inverse, which associates to a point, an element of the group, another point, which I call g minus one, such that the multiplication works. So now I will go away from the example of the functions on the group, and I will give a formal definition of what is a Hopf algebra. So what is this Hopf algebra? It is a vector space over the complex number. As I say, I could do things with R, but so sometimes people call this K, capital K, but it doesn't, for me, it's good enough to have complex number in general. So this is an algebra. What is an algebra? It's something, it's a vector space, which has a sum. Sum is always commutative. It has a product, which I defined before, mu. So I take two copies of the algebra and I give one element. And the product is not necessarily commutative. In my case, the algebras will be always associative. Hopf algebra are always associative. There are quasi Hopf algebra. You can generalize, but an algebra might or may not have a unity. In my case, it will. So it will be an algebra with a unity, an element, which is the neutral element in this product. And it is possible to multiply elements by complex numbers. And therefore, the element, if I take a complex number, it's like I'm considering it as a part of the algebra with this map. Eta, which takes a complex number, makes an element of the algebra, and the element of the algebra is this one. It's alpha times one. This may look like a fancy way of something which is obvious. If I can multiply, then it makes sense that if I multiply by two, by three, by I, the imaginary unity, then of course this is an element of the algebra if I have the unity. And this is, I write it this way, it will be clear why I use a symbol. It may have a norm, can be a Banach algebra, it may have an involution, can be a standard algebra. This I will not necessarily need. This one I will, the definitions here, I need. It is also, yes.
There F1, F2 are the complex functions, you mean?
The functions are in the complex.
Okay.
A complex number. In any case, if you want to ask question, you can, you can use the chat so that I will answer the proper point.
Okay.
Okay. I want this to be a co-algebra. As I said before in this example, co-algebra means that it is a co-product. Now, in the example, I was giving you the explicit coproduct, but in general, I have to be, the structure have to be compatible with each other. I cannot just give product and coproduct, and in fact, Products have to be, I cannot take a vector space and invent a product. A product will have to satisfy to be distributive and so on, number of properties. The product must be, for me, will be co-associative. Now, this is the formula, and I will, as an example of how to understand this formula, go slowly. So what I say is that I take the co-product, and then this circle means that I combine the two maps, and I combine to the map the identity times the co-product, or the co-products times the identity. If I do this, I have to find the same thing. Let me show this and how it relates to associativity, because I will use this kind of formula more than once. So this means the composition of operations. So let me concentrate on the left-hand side. The identity times the co-product combined with the co-product means that they first take this delta, act on a function, and I obtain a function of two variables. Remember as what we said before. Then I act with the identity times delta. This gives me a function of three variables, because this one takes the second variable and acts with the co-multiplication. So it makes the second variable become two variables. And this one doesn't do anything to the first variable. So at the end of the day, by doing this, I have a function of three objects. So take this delta of f, and I get a function of two variables. And then I act with the identity and delta, so I get a function of three variables. So both the left and the right hand side are functions of three variables. So what this is saying, that if I take the first variable and I split it, and I leave alone the second one, or I do vice versa, I should find the same thing. So if I do the operations in this, so I take a function, it becomes a function of two variables, then a function of three variables. Which variable I've split happens, it doesn't matter in the order in which I do. So you will, in the end, in one case, I will get f by looking at this. Where is it? By looking at this, no? So remember this. So if I, in the end, in one case, I get this f of g1, because I have put together g2 and g3, and then f of g1 times g2, g3, and then f of g1, g2 times the g3. So in our example of functions on the group, co-associativity relates to the associativity of the group. But it's more general. Of algebra are not necessarily functions on the group. I will give examples when they are functions and when they are not. So it's a more general thing, definition, and there are several other cases. One thing, an algebra, which is also a coalgebra, may be a co-associative but not associative, or associative and not co-associative. The two things are independent. Okay, we are not done with the definition. The Hopf algebra must have a co-unit. This is a map from the algebra into complex numbers. In the example that before, the co-unit means that there is one particular point, one element of the group which is special. I call it E, or sometimes I call it one. And this gives you, takes a an element of the algebra and gives a number. So epsilon of f is a number. And what is this number? It's the value of the function in the identity of the group. It has an antipode, and this has to do with the inverse. So this is a map that takes an element of the algebra and associates to it another element of the algebra. And this is the antipode of f. Is a function which, instead of being a function of g, is a function of g minus 1. In this way, I gave you an example of a Hopf algebra. So the functions on a group are Hopf algebra, but Hopf algebras are more general. In fact, I don't know Mr. Hopf if he introduced them for this or for something else, but definitely they are more general. And so if I have an algebra with some structures, multiplication, unity, and so on, co-algebra with co-multiplication, co-unity, so structures and co-structures, they have to be compatible with each other. I cannot just invent multiplications and co-multiplications. They have to be an algebra, they have to be compatible. And also a multiplication has to be, has to have some particular ways. And this is given by the commutativity of this diagram. This means that if I start in one, I follow one path, is the same as following the other one. So let me take associativity. I take three functions or functions of three variables. Then I use mu. Mu takes these two and let it to one times the identity. So I do something to the first two and I leave alone the second one. So I go to a functions of two variables in this way by multiplying the first two elements and I do something to the third one. Then I again use the multiplication and I end up to a single function. If I do it in reverse, I should get to the same element. And this is associativity because it means that if I first multiply the first two variables and then I multiply with the remaining variable, it's the same as multiplying first the second, the third, and do nothing to the initial variable. And then multiply the two things which are. So this is exactly, where did I write it? This is exactly this, no? So this is associativity written as a diagram. So I purposingly put a diagram which was the something we know. Now I have to have the identity and unity. So this is again, this has to do only with algebra, this first part, so known things. So I take a complex number and an element of the algebra, then I use this map eta. That's why I gave it a name. So I take eta, which acts on this complex number, and I do nothing to the algebra, so I end up with two elements of the algebra. With two copies of the algebra, so a function of two variables, then I multiply them and I end up some to some extent somewhere. Then this is the same as the fact that the tensor product of complex numbers times the algebra is leaves the algebra to be the same algebra. So again, it's a fancy way of showing this. But this is interesting because I want, and this is a general rule, that any diagram should hold for the co-structures inverting the arrows. So you see, the difference between the two, if I'm not made a mistake, is that wherever there is the unity, I put a co-unity, and wherever there was an arrow going down, I put an arrow going up. You see? This is the same. Again, if it's not, it's because I made a mistake in preparing these diagrams is not completely easy in LaTeX, so it's possible that an arrow makes a mistake. But this is the two, as I'm watching it, watching the thing, I think it's correct. So this it means that the co-product and the co-unit have to be compatible the same way as the product and unity have to be compatible, and this is associativity and this is co-associativity. But now, so So this is co-associativity, which is the dual of this associativity. This is the unit and co-unit. So this is the co-associativity. Now, co-multiplication and multiplications have to be compatible. Let me show you how this. I take two functions, and therefore two functions are functions of two variables. Then I act with the multiplication, and then I do co-multiplication. And I want that this is, in the end, I want that this is by inverting somehow the two things. So what is this? I take mu of f1 and f2, and I get f1, f2. This is the product of two elements of the algebra. The product is the function, the multiplicative function. So I write them as f1 times f2, no? Usually. And then I act with delta. In the end, I get something which is a function of two variables. Now I want these structures to be compatible, and I want that the function f1, f2, which is a function, acting on g1, g2, which is one single variable, has to be the same as f1 times f2. And this is how I multiply functions. No, if I take the product of the function sine times the function cosine is the function sine times cosine, and the value of the one point is sine of 33 pi is the same times cosine of 33 pi, would be zero, but 33.2 pi and 33.2 pi, and then I get this is the product of two functions. So if I start from this, I take two functions, I take the product of the functions, and then I do the co-multiplication, and I end up a function of two variables, which in the end is to be a number because I saturated everything. If I instead, I first do the co-multiplication, and then I multiply the two of them, and then I act on two variables, I should get the same thing. So this is shown by this diagram where the flip is this thing. It's not immediate. You want us to work a little bit about it. And if you sit down and take a few examples, the one that I gave above and the one that I do below, after half an hour, you really are proficient on this. This complicated thing is given by this diagram. And this diagram, so I start with two copies of the algebra. And this is the flip. Notice that this is self-dual. If I exchange delta with mu, and I change the arrow, and I change everything, I get especially the same diagram. No, because this goes from four copies to four copies, and if I flip, this is becomes the same thing. This goes up, but then this is this part here. This, and so I exchange these two, and this I have one. I exchange the two things, but in the end I get the same thing. I have to exchange the arrow and exchange mu with delta. And I end up with the same thing, no? Because this becomes the arrow up of mu times mu, so it becomes the same. So this diagram, which is a diagram which uses structures and co-structures, becomes the same. Okay, we are a little bit bored by now, at least I am. You have the advantage of muting me and do whatever you want with your life. I cannot do that. But there are some more properties, and they are compatibility. This is probably, this is important. I want to extend this to the full algebra, and I do by in linearity. So delta of the product is the product of the deltas. Delta of the sum is the sum of the delta, and everything has these things. I should give the co-product of the identity, which is just this one. And then I have Multiplication and co-unity have to be compatible, and this is the diagram. You have the registration, and I will send, if you want, also this the file. After the second lecture, when I finish, I will send the file. And so I have other diagrams, which I am flashing, quickly flashing. And I have the final diagram, which is another self-dual. See, when they use, also this is self-dual, it's not evident, you have to change the perspective a little bit. When I use structures and constructions, so diagrams have to be useful. And as I did here, if you want to, you can translate it, as I did here for this diagram, if you, you, it's a useful exercise to translate this, and you can change all these things. Now, Wikipedia, now a little comment. Wikipedia has some excellent pages on algebra and group theory, actually. So all these diagrams are there on Wikipedia. I was tempted of taking the pictures. And they're useful. I use them a lot. If I were to show you the Thunderbird, the Firefox, which I use, they have lots of Wikipedia pages. So I use them, I'm not saying this. But you should never study from Wikipedia. You should use Wikipedia, because once you have studied a topic the proper way, with books, with lectures better than mine, with notes, etc., then Wikipedia is a useful reference, because it allows you to navigate quickly, you can search in the page, but you should not, you cannot study from it. You can use it as a, again, as a useful reference. And it may be useful also at the beginning. I should say, sometimes you have no idea what is something, and you have a vague idea, and you want to know whether it has to do with something that you're doing. Then you can use Wikipedia just to know what is about. I was doing some work just 2 or 3 days before with a colleague, and he said, well, this I, once I had a seminar, this might have to do with the tropical geometry. And so we went on Wikipedia and looked at it and discovered that it had nothing to do with it. But that was quick. Instead of going to the library, getting a book, finding it, then it's at the beginning. If we had discovered that this was useful, then it was a good point to go get the books, study it. And then afterwards, if you don't remember a diagram, for example, if you now I may remember them because I looked at them in the past few days, but in standardly I don't remember these diagrams. I look at them, and Wikipedia is a quick way to find it. But because I studied them, I spent a lot of time on Majid's book, and I so this is so, I'm sorry, I'm white beard, I'm getting old, and oh, us old people have the tendency to teach constantly. Let me give you an example, SL2C. I could do SU2C by taking unitary, but I want to make my life slightly simpler, so I do SL2CQ. Q is the deformation. So, first of all, let me show you the structure without the deformation. So I take SL2C, those are 2 by 2 complex matrix of determinant 1. They are a group. So if I, determinant is multiplicative. So if I multiply 2 of these matrices, I still get a matrix. And the functions are functions of 4 numbers, because the elements of the matrix, there are 4 numbers, so T11, T12, and so on, with the determinant, which is, you know, is T11 times T22 minus T21, T12. This determinant should be equal 1. So the functions on the manifold are like this, those are the coordinate functions, no? So a function, I can express it as a combination of these numbers. I can identify the elements with the matrix elements, So these are like the coordinate functions. Namely, if I have an element of the group, which is a 4x4 matrix, I have four functions. You know, so I move the element of the group and these four numbers will change. These are the coordinate functions, and in general, a generic function will be a polynomial, or can be an infinite series of this matrix element. Okay, for those of you that are mathematically oriented, I hope that none of you is really strongly a mathematician, because I am a physicist, so I do the definitions and the structure which I need. Therefore, the rigor, mathematical rigor, is not there. I'm not mathematical rigor. If I have to be more specific, I have to define something which is called the group algebra. This is a linear space generated by the group elements, and I not only multiply them, and I sum them. Of course, this depends on the representation. No? Because if I start in the 2x2 representation, I get 2x2 matrices. If I start with 3x3, I get 3x3 matrices. But it's an abstract object which I can define, and then I can have its representation of the group algebra. Okay, now I want to give so this is telling me the coproduct. So if I take one element of this, which has to act on two variables, there should be probably a comma here in between. Let me flag this. This is for me, because when I will send to Professor Desiatri the file, I will correct these things which I am noticing as I go along. So here there should be a comma in between. And this delta TAB is a function of two variables. And so is the component, the tick of the 1-1 matrix element of the product of the two matrices. And we know what this is. It's the matrix multiplication. Okay, so now this is a different example than the one before. And the coalgebra structure is given by this. I don't put the sum over C. So repeated indices, which are one up and one down, are summed. And I can use this shorthand notation. So you see, this is the coproduct which knows about the group structure. Okay, the co-unit. Well, the identity is the matrix which has T11, which is 1, and T22, which is 1, and then the rest is 0. So this epsilon of a generic TAB, which is a function of the group, equals 2-1 only if A equals B, T11 and T22. The antipode instead are the matrix elements of the inverse matrix. Now the important point. TAB are numbers. The algebra is the group is a non-commutative group because I multiply matrices, but the entries that see the individual elements of the matrix, they are numbers. So if TAB is 23, if T11 is 23 and T22 is 2, their product is 46. And it doesn't matter if I write them one way or another, they are numbers, and I multiply the numbers in a standard way. It's the way I combine them which make a difference, but not that they are numbers. And now I write this expression in a very complicated way. I take a matrix R, which is a tensor, A, B, E, F, and I write all these things now. These are summed over because they are repeated. And I write this matrix with this index structure and I write it again with this in the structure, and this A, B, E, F are just are trivially the delta functions. So ta, 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 ta. And this is, if you put this delta here, you will see that I just rewrote this in a complicated way. Why did I do this? Because now I can consider a generic R, not this one, but another one, which puts them, this thing, together in a non-commutative way. The T's now are not commutative. So I have put a non-commutativity. This is A and B go between 1 and 2, so there are 16 numbers in total here. Those are numbers. And this one will not be numbers anymore. So I cannot take 16 numbers as I want, because I still want to have associativity, and I want to have, I may wish to have co-associativity and have these things. It is possible to find something. This is something which was coming from integral systems, and I will not discuss them. I will just give you the final answer to give an example. One can do by brute force, by writing 16 elements and start by, in fact, computer will probably do it in an efficient way, and see in which cases I can add this R matrix R. This matrix is called the Young-Baxter matrix. As I say, in reality, it's a tensor. And as a little comment, Young, you know, it's a very common name in China. I don't know how many millions and millions of Youngs there are. So Young-Baxter, this is basically pure mathematics. Well, this Young is the Young for us physicists. Chen-Ning Yang is still alive, he's 102, and is Yang Mills, Li Yang, and the mono Wu Yang of the monopole, other things. Well, this gentleman had time also to make important contributions in this theory. So this is Yang, and Baxter instead is a pure mathematician. I don't know how they got together. I think they did it actually together, but it's a pleasure for us physicists to say that one of us, not any one of us, is making contributions also in pure mathematics. Okay, I will, what the matrix, Young-Baxter is a generic matrix. This one works, where Q is any number. And this is just to give you an example, like I have no time to find this. But you see that when Q equals to 1, this becomes the identity, and this becomes 0. And so it is, this I put 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 1, 2, 2 on the row and columns. So this will be the delta that I said before. So when Q equal to 1, I find again the thing. This is like H bar going to 0, C going to infinity. The structure of this is very different if Q is a generic real number or a phase, and then the combined case. And it's also different if it's a phase which is a root of unity, so it's e to the I, rational number or not, but I have no time to do this. Let me show you again. If I write T, just not to have T11, T22, so let me write T in this way. So this is this object. And this non-commutativity tells me that alpha beta equals Q beta alpha, alpha gamma is Q gamma alpha, beta delta is Q delta, so, okay. So basically it's a product non-commutativity, you know, it's not the commutator, it's in the product. And this is the non-trivial one. and which is coming from this element here, no? Which is the only non-diagonal one. So beta and gamma are still commutative, and alpha and delta instead, they have this relation, which is a commutation relation. And if I define a Q determinant, which is the product of this minus Q, the product of this one, using this, the Q determinant is still equal to one. Notice that while before I was concentrating on the coalgebra, here I changed the algebra. But I need the Hopf structure to be consistent. So this R, I could find it only if I were to take into account only the coalgebra. It's like in some in books it's described why you find it. I just had no time. But I should also change the antipode. And sorry, here there is another parenthesis which is missing. And there will be many more mistakes, but those are the ones that I'm catching. So S of beta is not beta, but it's Q minus one of beta. And this other one are again the formation. In general, I should have that S of alpha should be delta. This is the antipode. I should exchange these two. And these two I will not change because I have to have the inverse matrix, no? The inverse matrix, I exchange these two because of the determinant equal to one. It's basically an exchange of those two. And the antipode more or less does that, except that deforms with the scheme. And this was simpler with one less constraint. If I were to have also the constraint that the matrix is unitary, then the same thing will go through. There are some other things. So as I did SL2C, I did also SU2Q. SL2CQ, SU2Q is the same thing with the same deformation and basically the same Young-Baxter algebra. Another example of a Hopf algebra, the universal enveloping algebra. Now, Hopf algebra, I was starting of talking of groups, but I could talk, could do everything with Lie algebras. And let me start with a generic Lie algebra. I assume that you have been introduced to Lie algebra. So Lie algebra is basically is this. It's an algebra. It's non-associative. It's an algebra, but which has this Lie bracket. It's not necessarily the commutator, unless I represent. There are Lie algebras that have no representation as matrices. So this is, it has Jacobi and everything. The universal enveloping algebra is the algebra which I generate by the identity, this chi, and then I keep summing and multiplying them, but taking into account that, I don't know, chi one is still zero, but chi one, chi two, say is chi three. So every time I find the combination chi one, chi two, chi 2, I can put chi 3, say, if I'm taking the algebra of SU2. So this is an algebra. It's technically, it's the quotient of the polynomials in this chi's modulo, this relation. So it's an algebra. If you take SU2, you'll get 2 by 2 matrices, all of them. And but in general, it can be something more complicated. And this is called the universal enveloping algebra. And on this, I can give the structure of Hopf algebra. The coproduct is chi times 1 plus 1 times chi. Remember that when I was talking of the group, the coproduct was delta, was this. This, in fact, is called the group-like coproduct. So it was t by t. Here, instead, is chi times 1 plus 1 times chi. It's not chi times chi. Why? Because this is infinitesimal, really. It's the infinitesimal version. And I have the other structure. This is 0. This is minus. It's not minus 1. It's not to the minus 1. And the identity as trivial, everything trivial. So this has to be 1. Why is this? Because if the delta of a product has to be the product of the deltas. And since this is the identity, the coproduct has always to be this one. So it's not 1 times 1 plus 1 times 1. This is one of the generators of this. The extension is done by linearity. Okay, now this is again is wrong. I think that there is what should this be? It's SU2 cube. Why it ended up like this, I don't know. SU2, I don't know what this is SU2. Let me apply a deformation of SU2. I don't know if you have seen SU2 in this form, but I'll write it in this way. X plus is you can answer in chat. Have you seen this form of SU2 already? Otherwise, I will explain it. Is there someone there? Okay.
Yeah, they must have studied the angular momentum algebra, so they must be familiar with this structure.
Okay. Okay, so is this... This is L plus, L minus, and this is L3. I write it in this way because it's the Cartan... Okay, thank you very much. You can mute your phones. So this is L plus, S minus, and this L3, L0, but I write this, you will see this when you do thinking diagrams, I'm quite sure, because this is the Cartan way of writing it. So this is the diagonal one, and these are the raising and lowering operators. Now we make a deformation, and I will take, instead of H, I will take 2, K plus and K minus. When Q, the limit goes to 1, you will find H in both cases. You have to make the limit in the proper way, right? This E to the Q alpha. I think probably Q has to go to 1. Ah, yes, of course, yes. H is not, I'm sorry, H is not LZ. It's twice times LZ in our definitions. I want to look at this. I may be off by a factor of 2. There is one little problem, is that some people use the Q and some other books use with Q by 2. So there are factors of 2. So since I was looking at different books, I might have this. So there may be some factors here which are wrong. I will, and I'm sure that there will be factor of 2 pi in which are wrong, but modulo this normalization issues. Okay, so now I make a deformation. These 2 k's, which are the exponentiation of h, I keep them commutative, but the commutator of x plus and x minus, I write it in this way. See, when q goes to 1, this goes to h. This is plus h minus h. And now the factor of 2 is important, because then I get h out by 2, h by 2. I make limit and I find the usual one. And then I have this element. So x plus minus with h. In general, I should get x plus minus. Instead, I will get this kind of thing. And the usual, the brackets go to what they have to go. Okay, now, if I Here there is a plus minus, which is missing. I can write the coalgebra in this way. You see, in general, I would have x plus and x, sorry, this is minus plus. This is chi minus pi inverted one. And so now this is a deformation, no? Because the Lie algebra would be one, sorry, this is also, this is k. Let me, if you are looking and you are looking at the registration, let me write. This is k. And this is k. So that in the limit, and this is x plus minus. I'm sorry, when I wrote this particular thing, so probably somebody must have distracted me. Probably I was looking at the US election or the things, and this formula is a bit off. I'm sorry, but so this is k, and again, and because I should have one times. Let me. Okay, I will correct this, but it's a deformation because of one times x plus minus times one, no, sorry, this is k, and this is k, and this is k plus minus, okay? So x plus minus, this is k plus, and this is k minus, and this is the same. So that in the limit, k goes to one, and this is the one which I said at the beginning, x times one plus one times x. In the limit, in the k goes to one, and again, really. And now I'm curious because there is a high density of mistakes here. Really, probably I was writing this when the results from the election were coming, and I was sort of constantly looking with the things and something. I'm sorry. There is a so in, it's in any book, and when I will send after the end of the lecture, when I will send this, I will make sure that this is correct. I'm sorry, and there is a R tensor which is complicated, and it's this one, and I copied it. And in order to do that, I use the so called Q numbers. So if I have a number n, it's an integer, but the definition works anyway. This is the q number n. And you see in the limit of q going to 1, this would be 0 over 0. But then if you make the expansion of this, you will find n. And the factorial is just if I have an integer, then I go decreasing. So in the limit of q going to 1, this becomes normally SU2. Otherwise, it's a deformation of this. So this, those are two examples. I have no time to go much into detail. I'm sorry. I started at 9:30. I have 15 minutes to go, more or less. Okay. Duality. Okay. Now, if I have Hopf algebra, I have its dual. And this is very important because lots of these things are built by duality. If I have a Hopf algebra, I have this dual. The dual in this, dual means lots of things. Everything is dual to something else. But duality here means the space of linear maps. So if I have an algebra, it's a vector space. And I have another vector space, which is the space of linear maps. And I use the notation, this following notation. So if I have an element of the algebra, this is a complex number. And it's linear, distributive, and so on. So A and A prime are vector spaces. So A is a vector space, A prime is a vector space. But if A is a Hopf algebra, A prime also is a Hopf algebra. So the presence of a Hopf algebra structure on a vector space gives a Hopf algebra structure on the dual of the vector space. And you will see that everything I was building was actually is a trick to build to do the things. And I must give the rules. So I have A1, which is the spaces of this psi. I should give the rules for the multiplication, unit, co-unit, and antipode. And here are the definition. The definition adjusted dualizing. So I should define the product, tensor product, and the tensor times the tensor product, and I just take the multiplication. This is how to define to the tensor product. So how do you define the product? This must be F. So this is so how do I define the product between two linear applications with the co-product on the dual part? So now this makes sense because this is an element of the tensor product of the two. And you see, I act with the tensor product, I use this one. So I have defined how to find the product. How do I define the unit then with the co-unit of the algebra? How do I define the co-product of the psi with the product on the Fs? Okay, so duality, and everything is dual. So if I have one of algebra, automatically on the space of linear functions, I find the Hopf algebra structure. Now, if the Hopf algebra is commutative, the dual will be co-commutative. Okay? Because what does it mean to be commutative? It means that F times G is the same as G times F, which means that if I take two functions, I flip them and then I multiply, it's the same as multiplying them without flipping. This means that the Hopf algebra is co-commutative. This means that the Hopf algebra is not commutative. If I take a function and I do the delta, and I flip it. So this is the same as saying that delta of F is the same as saying this probably, I have a tablet, so I should have written this. This is the same as saying, so I want that, is the same as saying that, delta of F of G1 and G2 is the same as delta F of G2 and G1. So if delta of F is the one that says is 1 times F plus F times 1, then this is co-commutative. Or also if it is F times F. But examples that I gave elsewhere were not. This with the wrong one, the K and something. So the algebra, if the algebra is commutative, the co-algebra is dual co-algebra is co-commutative and vice versa. Now, the group that I introduced, the algebra was commutative. The group was not, but the algebra, the functions were commutative. And now, why did I give this example? Because the dual of this algebra, or the group algebra, is the universal enveloping algebra of the Lie algebra of the group. So this is the connection between group quantum groups and quantum Lie algebra. They are all Hopf algebra, but in one case are the functions on the group. and in the other case, they are the elements of the algebra itself. So, how do I do this pairing? Okay, the elements of the Lie algebra are invariant vector fields on the group manifold. So they act. I can write the I don't know if again, let me take again my pad here. So if I have the Lie algebra, the one that we know and love, no? Li Lj equals epsilon jk Lk. And then Li L1 is x2 d3 minus x3 d2, no? And with this, I can act on the wave functions psi. Yeah, I'm doing it in reverse, no? I'm calling the elements of the algebra psi of... Okay, so this is the Lie algebra, and then I take e to the I alpha L1, and this is the Lie algebra, this is the group, and this is the infinitesimal version. Now, if I do the universal enveloping algebra, here I will have the arbitrary derivatives, and so this is the space of vector fields and their generalization. And I have, this is the pairing, no? The pairing is, if I have this element of the vector algebra which acts on a function, I can act, and I have another function, and I calculate in the identity. And this delta, and there was a question at the beginning, this is the Leibniz rule, which connects the two of them. But in the coalgebra, this is also Jacobi. You know that Jacobi and associativity are the same. And here, actually, I've written what I was prepared. So take Jz, which is the derivative with respect to phi, the simplest case. Delta of J phi, which act on F1 times F2, is this. No, because I know this is the co-product for the Lie algebra. And this is a saying that this, therefore, pairing with two functions gets this, and this is Leibniz rule. So this is the connection between the two. Okay, I think that, let me see how big this is. This is slightly, okay, I don't know, Atri, do I have 10 minutes more or technically I have 7, but I will, can I go on a little bit beyond?
Yeah, I think you can go.
Okay, I will go a little bit. I will not exaggerate. I promise I will not exaggerate. I will just do action and coaction. Algebras, because I'm getting close to physics and I'm keen on getting close. Thank you, you can mute your. Algebra represents symmetries and they act on structures, okay? So when I talk of the algebra, rotations, everything, then I have in mind that they act on something. And the centers of rotations, for example, no. Algebra act on other algebra. So now let me take a Hopf algebra, which I will call H, and an element A of an algebra. So the Hopf algebra is also an algebra, and I take now A is an algebra and H is a Hopf algebra. The action I will indicate with this triangle, H acts also on itself. Therefore, the product of the two elements, I can write it this way. So I product of two elements is the algebra acting on the algebra acting on A. let me use another notation. Sometimes this is called Swidler notation. If I have a delta of h, I'll write it in this way. Delta 1k, this delta is not the Kronecker delta, it's just a small case of this delta. So it will be something, a sum, no, of 1 times t plus t plus 1, or can be an only element, f times f. But I will write it in this way. It's a shorthand notation. And I can define an action which preserves the structure. This is the covariant action. So if I have h, which acts on a product, it's the same as having delta of h acting on a1 and a2. So this will be a sum. When you see this parenthesis, means that there is a sum. I was acting on the, from the left, but I can act on the other side from the right, and I have the same thing. And there is a duality. If I have A and A prime, so the dual of A, I can act with H on this element B, or I can act on the other side with a different action in general on the other one. So if I have, this is a dual, this is a dual of this, and I can act on both of them. And the important example here is translation. They are part of the Poincaré group, but they are the trivial part. And they are a very trivial of algebra, because the commutator is zero, the coproduct is this, and the co-unit antipode, they're really simple. But from this, I can reconstruct Minkowski space. Why? Because they are in the dual. If I define this, where this is the metric, Minkowski metric or computer Euclidean, so I know, I say that this is the dual of this, and I have this coproduct. Now I can find an op algebra for the x, because as I say, it's dual, I play with the dual. And the dual, by using the rules of duality, I find another trivial algebra. So the x's commute, no wonder, I guess they are the coordinates of space-time, they commute, the coproduct is trivial, and everything is trivial. But this I can see using the canonical action, because I know as few act on x, acts in this way, but I can write it as x times p mu, but this is p mu and mu, so this is eta mu nu. So all I need is this. Then I use the rules which I have said for the dual part. Okay. I extend by duality. And I know that if translations commute, they will act on coordinates which commute with themselves. And not only is important that translations commute, but that this is also true. Okay, that they have a trivial coalgebra structure, the dual, which is the coordinates, will be trivial. And and I have this this thing which I should have this compatibility of everything. Now I will stop here. What I will do tomorrow is to deform this. So I will introduce you this kappa Poincaré, and I will motivate physically this very much. And I will show you how one can have a space-time which is non-commutative, but which is has some symmetries, but the symmetries are quantum symmetries. So basically, tomorrow we go back to physics. I don't know how theoretical you are, whether you consider quantum gravity a physical theory, but this is what I will try to do. I think I will finish for today. I'm sorry, I'm 9 minutes. No, I'm fine. No, 10, 11. Oh, no, I'm exactly fine. I finished exactly at 11. I'm surprised. okay, if there are questions, you can ask them either in voice or.
Yeah, so Fedele, I just wanted to ask you some question. Let's see, you have so far you have defined, let's see, you have given a prescription for constructing this dual Hopf algebra. And since you started with the commuting momenta, you are ending up with the commuting coordinates also. Then if you deform it, you are going to generate non-commutative algebra.
Yes.
And as you said, tomorrow you are going to talk about the kappa type of deformation, how you are going to get it. But I am wondering, suppose the usual Drinfeld twist, which is used to deform the Hopf algebra and to construct the Moil kind of algebra. So there also, can you go through this kind of prescription?
I don't know. I'll tell you why. I was hoping to do the twist and Kappa Minkowski. You know, I worked on both of them, and so did you. I'm not sure I'll make it on time. I have it because this is part of, I volunteered to give this because I gave a series of lectures. I was doing a course in group theory in Naples, and therefore I was, the last part was this group theory. However, I should say that here I have 3 hours and there I had 5 hours, so I had to compress, and I'm not sure I will. So I will give one example, which is the Kappa Poincaré, which is older and more. For reason which I will say, I like it now more, although I'm guilty of working on the other one as well. I will, if I have time, I will mention also the so-called Theta Poincaré, the other example which gives you the Moyal product and so I will, or let me say, I will certainly mention it. How much of it I will do, I have done 30 pages out of 40, which I've already prepared. Unfortunately, the other lecture was on the blackboard, but to give this lecture, I had to write this, which is good because I had to re-prepare it anyway. I don't promise, Bishwait, that I will do, that I will have time to do it, but I'll try. Since you asked for it, I will try at least to mention it. I will give one example more in detail and then I'll mention it.
But it can be done, right? I'm just wondering, is this prescription, yes, seems to be
With this structure, you can have these two, let me see, there are, what Bishwait is saying, there are two famous non-commutative geometries. One is this, X mu, I theta mu nu, and this is called, this gives you the modal product that appears in the screen, fiber width and so on and so forth. And the other one is, this is x0, xi equals I, 1 over something which is called kappa, lambda, I. I will discuss this more because the structure here is kappa Poincaré, it has more structure. This is coming from, as I say, kappa Poincaré. And this is called, coming from Drinfeld. I decided to do this because it's more structure. But I will mention this one. I will mention this one as well. So that there are ways, because you see, I'm anticipating something I say tomorrow. Clearly, you are breaking Lorentz symmetry here. And so you say, okay, very good. We have listened to this, all these lectures before, the importance of symmetries, and then you come, you do non-commutative geometry without breaking the symmetry. But I am breaking the symmetry with the group symmetry, but I still have a symmetry, which is a quantum group symmetry. And so this is the aim of this thing which I'm doing. And I have chosen to do this one, but I hope that there are no other questions. Say, can you do this? Because this at least I can do. This I could do. I worked on this. If I'm competent, well, I'm incompetent in anything, but I can try. Then there are many more things, applications, it's not a matter of time, it's a matter of me, competence in doing things. But Majid Books has lots of good examples. Okay, there are more questions?
Hello, sir. Anisha here. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, so can you repeat the reason behind taking the coproduct of a function as f cross identity plus identity cross f rather than taking f cross f?
Okay, they are, let me go back. They are both possible, but, okay, no, let me again do this. So Anisha's question is, I have two co-products. One is, I call it delta of F, which is F cross F. And the other one is delta of T, is 1 cross T plus, this is plus T cross 1. Now, this is group-like, and this is Lie algebra-like. Lie algebra. Why is this? Because group-like means that this f, which is a function of g, g belongs to g. And I want that f, delta f, which acts on g1 and g2, must be equal to f of g1, g2. So delta f of g1, g2, I want this because I know that functions on groups, they have to respect the structure of the group. But if I do delta f, and if I do delta f equals of f times f, now this is as becoming a function of two variables, g1 and g2. And therefore, I somehow want this f times f to be f of so if you do this, you will get this. If instead I have, let me take t to be a derivative which acts, now derivatives now acts on functions, no, it's dual now, this acts on function, don't confuse the elements, this could be x, no, that the elements of the space. So delta instead acts on psi of, this is psi of x, but the elements of which the delta acts is this. And I want that acting on two of this psi and phi, I don't want delta psi, delta phi, which he said is what I get with this sort of a co-product. I want delta psi times phi plus psi d phi. And this state is given by this product. Delta of this delta equals delta times 1 plus 1 del times the derivative, no? Because this is something which acts on psi and phi and then gives you this. So this is when I act on functions on a group, and this is said when I act on something else. But the co-product may be different. They are the two standard one, no? The one which are used in these two examples, and they are one dual to the other, because exactly because of this. Because if you act by taking this, so here delta f, I have it here. If you go and you look, no, I don't want to get confused, and I did it here. Delta of two functions. The example of the coproduct. Anyways, I did it somewhere. The f of g1, g2. I realize this is for associativity. Anyway, I did it at some point here. Here. This is the co-multiplication. So it's delta of f is this one, then delta f of this one is delta f of the product. So you get the product for the group. But I repeat, is it can be anything. The co-product is anything. In fact, I will see others in general where they are deformations of this one which I say. But not all of algebras are deformations. Eh? The one that I want to do quantum mechanics, quantum gravity, then I want to have deformations or to something which become classical. But there are off algebra studied in mathematics which are non-deformation. That is, the Feynman diagrams, the set of Feynman diagrams, no, you know, the Feynman diagrams if I have a process at field theory, then I have all the Feynman diagrams with loops and subloops, etc. And this is a space which has a Hopf algebra structure, which is based on like graphs. Kohn and Kreimer found this. This is not a deformation of any usual classical algebra. So it's another example in which there is not a parameter going to zero. It's a combinatorial. There are lots of Hopf algebras in combinatorial, doing combinatorial things. Okay, when do you have the next lecture? I don't remember. Anyways, I can answer questions. And if you want, you have my mail. If you send me some mails, I can answer also after we finish this meeting.
Okay, Ferelli, before you wrap it up, I would like to ask you one more simple question. When you deform this SL2C group, there you have using the non-trivial R matrix.
Yes.
Then you have this kind of relation, no? Alpha beta equal to some Q times beta alpha kind of thing. So it seems that alpha beta or whatever this number, they cannot be the usual numbers.
If no, you no, have, no. They are Q numbers, in fact. They are called Q numbers. They are not numbers.
So can you find some representation of these numbers through some matrices again or something? Or you just postulate this kind of
number? No, you cannot. This you can find something. It's very different if this Q is a real or a face. If it is a face, then I can find this is a Weyl system. alpha is like e to the position, and beta is e to the momentum, and q is e to the I h bar, basically. Then I can find some not finite dimensional, but von Neumann theorem, infinite dimensional representations. If alpha is a real number, I cannot. Doesn't mean that there can be somebody that knows it, but I know it cannot be finite dimension. They cannot be matrices of matrix. They will be like position and derivative. They will be complicated objects. So the question is, can you find a matrix? No. If can you find an operator? Yes. If Q is a phase, probably yes. But I don't know. It's more studied the case when Q is a phase for obvious reasons, and then you can find it. But it's derivatives. It's exponential of derivatives. So. is something. So one, because otherwise this will become a group. This quantum group is not a group. I cannot express it as a group. It's a deformation of the group. And that's what makes it more interesting. In fact.
Okay, so anybody else has any question?
Okay.
Actually, I have some remark that for the case of charged particle moving in magnetic field, the usual Hamiltonian is not invariant under translation. One can define some magnetic translation operator. I think magnetic translation operator satisfy this Q deform SL2 Q C algebra. Right?
Yes.
Am I right?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Then Q is like a phase. It depends on the magnetic field.
Exactly, because the particle in a magnetic field is a non-commutative geometry, you know, the Tau levels. So it's another. There are many examples. I'm sorry, this is limited, but and if you, some of the colleagues and friends have more examples to mention, they are welcome. I am not afraid of showing ignorance, because it's a big and fascinating, one should never be afraid of showing ignorance, we are all ignorant, but it's a vast and fascinating topic, and I don't think there is really anyone that can know the whole thing, so comments are always welcome in various aspects, and so it's like group theory is bigger, but it's a little corner, and I don't think there is anyone. Well, in group theory there are people that know all the various aspects of group theory, but since quantum groups are complicated because they are more young, I don't think there are people that really know everything about it. Which is good. I mean, it's a fascinating. I like it very much. I like it a lot. Okay.
And another thing, last point, regarding applications, I don't know, but this Young-Baxter equation seems to have some good application in statistical mechanics.
Yeah.
Do you have any idea about it?
No. No. I heard some seminars, etc., but I never really studied it. No, but there are applications in statistical mechanics and everywhere. But let's try. I'm sure if you write, let's make an experiment in Young, Baxter, COVID. Let's see if somebody. As already, no, not yet. But, No, we only say that, but give it a little bit of time and there will be application of quantum groups to COVID because it's the fashionable thing. My colleague Francesco Sandino has done some work of applications of the renormalization group to the epidemiological situation of COVID. So it's another of the things that comes to mind, no? Renormalization group. We all know a little bit of renormalization group because we did Feynman diagrams, etc. But then the renormalization group appears everywhere, and Sandino makes it appear also in the COVID. It's a matter of time before we'll have COVID and renormalization, which is good. Actually, it's an important topic. Anybody that can help. There are lots of people that are not helping. They are creating confusion. It's something. Okay.
Okay, then, Fedele.
Okay.
So,
I deserve another. No, now probably I will go to a milder tea. For me, it's 11 in the morning. I go to a milder tea, too much assumpti, and then I will not sleep. Okay, good. Who is talking after me today?
I'll talk just next after that. Frederick Scholes will be talking. So
Okay.
he'll be giving his third talk. Actually, his last talk was very nice. I think today, if you can spare time, you can attend his talk.
I
It was
have
really.
I actually watched I watched Professor Dasgupta to know more or less what was done. I watched them at a higher speed. So and I should I don't know if Professor Dasgupta I'm impressed. He's a master didactics. In fact, I'm embarrassed to follow. It's really gives some excellent lectures. And as I try to, and on and off, I heard some of what you were saying, what Sachin was saying. Occasionally, I connect. Occasionally, I connect. Okay. Then now I will go and get something, some extra bread. Okay.
Now, sorry that we cannot even provide you over the
No, it's
webinar.
not 12. It's not 9. It's not 12. 9:30 for me is not 12. It's I have done before. My wife, that is currently flying to Japan, she works a lot with Japan. Now she's actually moving there for a while, and she has to have sometimes some conferences at 5 in the morning. So we are used to this globalization, which forces people to do things at funny times. Okay.
Thank
Then
you for coming.
Okay,
Ciao.
bye. See you tomorrow.
See you tomorrow. Yes. Ciao, everyone. Bye bye.
Yeah.
Ciao.
Thank you. Bye.